Good afternoon. I'm Warren Hoag, IPI's Senior Advisor for External Relations, and I'm happy to welcome you to this Global Leader Series event focusing on the upcoming selection of the person who will be the next Secretary General of the United Nations. IPI plans to present all the official candidates for the post, and our guest today, and actually the first guest inaugurating this series, is Vesna Pusić, the Deputy Speaker of the Parliament of Croatia, and formerly the country's first Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Foreign and European Affairs. You in the audience have her full biography in your papers, but for the sake of those of you who are following this via video, in addition to having served as a parliamentarian and a government minister, Dr. Pusić has been an academic researcher, university lecturer and professor, an NGO director, international negotiator, a rights activist, co-founder of a feminist organization, and the leader of her political party. We have asked her to speak for 10 minutes, and then we will go directly to the question and answer period. So please join me in welcoming to IPI Dr. Vesna Pusić.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, and thank you for inviting me, and thank you for coming to this discussion, this talk, and giving me this opportunity. As far as the things I've done in my life go, this is what happens when you have a very long life and you manage to do all kinds of things. But one thing I didn't expect was that I would be part, and I must say I'm very excited about that, that I would be a part of the first a little bit more open process of selection of the Secretary General of the United Nations. A process where to be a candidate means something, because it gives you a chance to present yourself, it gives you a chance to see the organization, learn a lot about the organization, learn a lot about the people surrounding it and caring about it, and finding out also how, in some cases, people have very strong feelings and opinions about the organization and about the performance of the organization. For the last 4 years, I have been foreign minister and minister for European affairs of my country. And in those 4 years, things have changed dramatically. One thing that I experienced firsthand was participating as the foreign minister in, for instance, the NATO ministerial meetings. When I started out, a regular part of the NATO ministerial meetings was the so-called NATO-Russia Council. We always met with, as part of the meetings, we always met with the Russian foreign minister. In these four short years, that changed. This was abolished after Ukraine. And gradually, if you look in the last 10 years, a number of different fora where countries could talk to each other have either disappeared or been suspended. So I would say that in the last 10, 15, and especially last 5 years, the importance of the United Nations grew. The fact that this is one place where all countries could actually talk to each other has become more important than it was, and more true than it was 5 or 10 years ago. You remember the famous concept of sort of the end of history and basically overcoming all the conflict. This wasn't true, unfortunately didn't happen. And if anything, from suspicions that United Nations would become obsolete and even very loud comments in that direction, what happened in real life is the exact opposite. The United Nations became, I think, increasingly more important and increasingly the place where countries can meet and talk to each other. And me coming from a country that has, in my lifetime, in my adult lifetime, been at war, I cannot put sufficient importance to talking. I would say that talking is, a million years of talking is better than one day of war. So to have an organization when you can sit down and talk and meet becomes very, very important. One of the key objectives of this organization, and one of the things they asked us to do, and I will here very quickly repeat for you what I think are, let's say, some new ideas that I might be able to bring to the process. One of the things they asked us to do as candidates for this post of Secretary General was to state briefly what we would do in three or four specific areas that are the key or the core business of the United Nations, one being peace and security, the other being development, the third being, or maybe sometimes the first, depending on who you're talking to, being management and efficiency of the organization, the human rights and promotion and protection of human rights. And I have written with the idea that in each of these areas, I would need to maybe contribute something that would make that particular aspect of the United Nations function a little better or a little bit more imaginative or innovative, and therefore with more energy, at least in the first period. Because as you know, if something new is introduced, it always motivates, if it's interesting, motivates people more. And with the understanding that also some of the fundamental and major changes of the organization will take a long time. So the next Secretary General will definitely have to combine two things. One, doing with what she's got. In other words, there are certain instruments that you have, and let's try to make the most out of that. And gradually trying to make procedures, decision-making simpler. That is probably the prerequisite for then eventually also making it more efficient. So the peace and security has been one area in which the United Nations have been recognized and perceived for decades as the sort of key authority and key player. However, we are facing a sort of a situation of new age wars, wars that have changed in character, wars where civilian population is not casualties or are not sort of the accidental casualties, but are actually the targets of the wars. The war in which the difference between civil war within a country and classical war among countries are merged into one, and every war becomes both. Wars in which the terrorism and, as they're officially called, non-state actors, in other words, thugs that go and terrorize, kill people based on or loosely justified by some kind of ideology, but are basically becoming international and way less predictable. And wars in which sexual violence and targeting women and children has become a weapon of choice. So the wars have changed in nature. I observed that change beginning in the wars in Croatia and Bosnia-Herzegovina in the 90s, but it has become only more so. Also, the issue of UN peacekeepers and the division between the North and South that occurred here, meaning that the northern states mainly are prepared to provide funds, but not the soldiers, and the southern states are mostly providing soldiers. There hasn't been a lot of efficient screening here, a lot of efficient selection here, a lot of efficient supervision of the blue helmets. So there were some very dramatic and very damaging things that occurred lately. But if you ask me, obviously this is something that needs a lot more attention, a lot more supervision, a lot more attention to the command structure and accountability. However, if you ask me which aspect or which element I would focus on primarily within this peace architecture, peacekeeping and peacebuilding architecture, I would say that one element that I see as underused here are the negotiators, because you need the soldiers to keep the warring parties apart. For everything else, for the so-called scanning the horizon, in other words, identifying whether there is a threat, preventing that threat, negotiating ceasefires, negotiating peace, which is way more complicated than ceasefire, but there's no peace without first having ceasefire, you need negotiators. And UN has had some fantastic negotiators, such as Lakhdar Brahimi or Staffan de Mistura, and some really excellent people. But it doesn't have institutional memory. It doesn't have sufficient strength in this area to use negotiators as the leaders in peace making and peace brokering, and also securing some of the fundamental prerequisites for eventually creating sustainable peace. So this would be something that I think UN needs to focus on, and also develop a kind of institutional intellectual property, knowledge, insight, experience that would help in the future. The other thing that is surprising when you start looking into the way the organization functions is how little interaction there is between peacemaking, especially building sustainable peace, and implementation of development objectives or development goals. Coming from the sort of practical, on-the-ground experience, there is no way you can have sustainable peace without having development, without introducing new projects and working on development as the alternative to war and post-war situations. You need to offer jobs, you need to rebuild institutions, you need to rebuild the infrastructure. That all has to do with development. So there is no sustainable peace without development. And the 17 development goals that the UN has defined, I think, are great, important. And I was here when they were voted on last fall. And since then, nothing. And I don't see them. I see everybody discussing, for instance, the peace and security aspects of the United Nations, but not working development objectives and development cooperation and these development goals into this whole concept, into this whole project. Development is part of peace and security. And I personally cannot see how it can be any other way. There are two things that struck me when going through the development goals. They are very different, but there are two things that they have in common. Almost all of them emphasize that they have to be all-inclusive. They have to be, whatever they're doing, they have to do it for all. And they have to be sustainable. In other words, they have to last. Whatever achievements they make, those have to last. These are the simplest and the most difficult objectives of all. And I would say that in all of development goals, these two things are the most difficult and the biggest challenge and should be specifically under the special care and focus of the next Secretary General. I will stop here because I think I've exhausted my 10 minutes. But I also have, of course, some thoughts on human rights, which has been sort of a leitmotif of my life, which has been spent in academia and the civil society and politics, both in opposition and in government, way more in opposition than in government, but still. So, thank you very much, and I'm prepared to answer all the questions.
I'm sure you can hear me still. I'm sure you will get a question on human rights. What we're going to do now is go directly to question and answer. I'm going to get out of the way here and just call on people. I've told Dr. Pusić we will take three at once, and she will answer them all after the three have been asked. If you would simply raise your hand, I'll call on you. Wait for the microphone. Please identify yourself. I'll start with this gentleman here, and that gentleman there. You see who you are? And there in the corner, okay? So one, two, three.
Oh, thank you. Hi, my name is Sebastian Mallow with Reuters.
So it might help if you stand up because we've got such a big crowd back there.
Sure.
They'll hear you more easily that way.
So Sebastian Mallow with Reuters. My question is, in announcing her candidacy on Monday, former Prime Minister of New Zealand, Helen Clark, essentially positioned herself as a gender-neutral candidate. She said, and I quote, she never sought election as a woman. So what is the importance, in your view, of running for the position of Secretary General as a woman?
Thank you. Second here, George.
Thank you, Warren. George Baumgarten, UN correspondent for Jewish newspapers in North America and also for some East African and other publications. Particularly in view of your assertion, Dr. Pusić, that negotiators in general have been underused. What do you think the UN can do, a new Secretary General could do, to encourage negotiations between Israel and the Palestinians? And my God, what can be done to about the UN's, particularly the Human Rights Council's, fixation with condemnations of Israel, often at the expense of not condemning other countries with vastly worse human rights records.
Thank you. And then in the corner.
Hi there, James Reinl from Al Jazeera. Thank you so much for the briefing and good luck with your candidacy. A couple of questions on specifics. Say you had been Secretary General during these two current terms. Is there anything you'd have done differently? I'm thinking specifically in terms of specific examples here. In Haiti, for example, would you have authorized the payment of compensation to Haitian victims of cholera, which the UN is not doing? And if you'd been SG during these last two terms, would we have seen more peacekeepers in the dock for sexual crimes in places such as CAR?
If you can take your three.
Thank you very much. I'm not a gender neutral candidate. I can't say that. I think this is a very important thing. And I've been through the whole transformation, so to speak. I was started being active on these issues as a young woman, which was many decades ago, in my 20s. And I also thought at that time, for instance, that quotas were not necessary in politics and different things. And I think it's sort of natural for a young, ambitious person to think, you know, I can beat them at anything and I can win without any support. But it's not about you, personally. It's about changing the way institutions function and societies think. And the ones that had quotas don't need quotas now. Scandinavians don't need anything. I mean, it's just as a matter of course, they are at worst 40-60 and at best 50-50, which I think is what it should be. And it's because maybe one day in the hundreds of years from now in the future, you won't have such differences in the human experience between men and women, in the sense you go through life, the obstacles you meet, the tasks you're given, the dilemmas you're faced with, the insecurities you're faced with. Both genders are faced with all of that, but they differ. And I think it is important to have both experiences as part of everything, running a country, running an organization, running whatever you're running. On top of that, I think that some things, considering the way the world today is, our societies are, some things, in order to evaluate, you actually need to look only, or it's sufficient, to look at the position of women. If women are terrorized, prevented from getting an education, prevented from getting jobs, sexually abused, genitally mutilated, it's not a good society. And you don't need, this is sufficient, so to speak. And I think under current circumstances, you could use women as a universal litmus test of whether a society is functioning well and going in the good direction or not. So I think it's important, actually, to have that concept. And I would definitely have it, as you can see. This is probably one of the most difficult questions, and some good people have tried negotiating a peace between Israel and the Palestinians, and some good people, not only international negotiators, but some good people from Israel and from the Palestinian side have tried. There are probably very many additional interests that work there and work in the region and are attached and have prevented finding a peaceful solution here or finding a modus vivendi here. But I think that without finding a solution for this particular problem, in a way, that's not Israel-Palestinian problem, that's world problem. And without finding a solution to this and a way these people can live peacefully and reasonably comfortably next to each other, we will not have globally achieved peace regardless of what is happening in other parts of the country. I'm not smarter than all the people that have tried. So I cannot tell you that, you know, I would find the deus ex machina here that could solve that. But I would definitely insist on trying some of the and sending some of the best people to talk to both sides continuously and without giving up. And this is the best I could say and I think do. Without prejudice, without preconditions, just sort of try to talk to both sides and see how far we can get, both to the governments and to the civil society. Having had personally this experience that when governments wage wars, civil societies sometimes can provide for the alternative. This is what we tried and did to some extent in our part of the world.
Could I just add one thing? Yeah. George mentioned a specific thing, which is a widespread perception that the Human Rights Council, which is not under the Secretary General and is in Geneva, still reserves particular rancor for Israel and at the expense of other countries which might have worse human rights records. I just wonder if you want to comment on that or if you...
Yeah, sure. No, I just had last year the experience, and we discussed it a little bit before I came in here, this experience of this... voluntary review of human rights conditions in the country. And I reported on my country, and having come from a human rights and civil rights background, I tried to really be honest as much as I could and tried to because I think it's also a matter of self-respect not to lie about your own human rights record. Certainly doesn't go in to your advantage. But what I could see, I mean, their comments are based not so much on the human rights record. Comments are based on the political relations of among different countries. And countries are criticized by countries that otherwise have bad relations with that country, or praised because the country that's speaking has good political relations with the country. Having said that, I think that it's primarily really Israeli, should be primarily an Israeli objective and goal to strive towards high standards in human rights. That's not saying that there are probably tens and tens of countries that have a worse human rights record. You're probably completely right there. There are tens and tens of countries that have a worse human rights record than my country. But I would definitely, and have spent all my life criticizing our own human rights records primarily, and trying to improve human rights standards in Croatia, because when all is said and done, you always care the most about your own environment. And I think that should make you more critical rather than more tolerant of human rights abuses. Syria and no.
Haiti.
It wasn't Haiti.
Haiti and cholera. And then what to do about peacekeepers who...
Who
were accused of sexual misbehavior.
Who sexual violence among peacekeepers. I was actually asked that question. I really would have to look into it and understand exactly. And as a Secretary General, the only thing I would promise, or as a candidate, I would promise to do if elected, is look closely into this. Because if there was, depending on how this happened and how these cases were developed and what happened there, the decision would have to be made on how the UN should react and act in this case. So I cannot answer this question without really understanding exactly what happened and what the findings were of the commission in Haiti. And just as a sort of security matter or safety measure, better than security, I wouldn't promise any money to anybody before I looked into the case at hand, into the situation that we have to deal with. Sexual violence or sexual misconduct. I mentioned this briefly in my introductory remarks, or sort of something that's closely related to. There are a lot of imbalances as far as the peacekeepers are concerned. But one very simple rule should be that a military that has committed sexual violence and crimes of sexual violence in their own country cannot provide peacekeepers. This is, I think, a rule that should be followed. And in the case of Central African Republic, for instance, this was one problem that they faced. Of course, there are cases when this has not happened in the country and still happened in peacekeepers still were involved or charged with rape and sexual violence. For that, I think chain of command and very competent command is an extremely important element. Mixing the makeup of the peacekeepers that are on the ground. 20 years ago, there were peacekeepers 20 kilometers from my home in my own country. We had all kinds of problems, but we didn't have that problem. Mm-hmm. And it was a very mixed makeup of the so-called AMPROFOR, that's what they were called in Croatia and in Bosnia-Herzegovina. We had very known and respectable command structure. We all knew, for instance, that it was General Nambiar who was in charge of UMPROFOR, and everybody could sort of access and communicate. So it needs, I would say, a much stricter selection process, hands-on approach, looking at the troops that are going to be there, and very carefully selecting the command, and absolutely not letting one single case pass of impunity pass. I mean, it has to be always sanctioned, and everybody has to know that this will be treated as war crime, what it is. Absolutely one of the probably worst kinds.
Okay, we'll take three more questions. I'll go to the back there on the corner, number one, number two here, Manik, and number three in the second row.
Hello.
My name is Mel Duncan from Nonviolent Peace Force. In building on your experience that civil society creates alternatives when governments wage war, civil society is providing direct protection through unarmed civilian protection of civilians under threat in areas like South Sudan and Myanmar. These approaches that are underutilized have been recognized by both HIPPO and the 1325 review. So as Secretary General, what would you do to increase this resource so that more civilians can be protected?
Okay.
I might add that almost half of the civilian protectors are women.
My second question was?
No, it's not me.
Yes, Manik.
Hi, Manik Mehta, syndicated journalist. We have been witnessing since 70 years a lot of debate on reforming the UN, and particularly the Security Council. How would you tackle this differently? Would that be one of your priorities? Thank you.
And finally, here in the second row.
Hello, I'm Jean Krasno, and I'm at City College of New York and Columbia University, and I teach courses on the UN for too many years. But in regard to the Sustainable Development Goals and Goal 5, particularly
on the microphone up a little bit.
Oh, on the empowerment of women and girls. A recent study showed that in the upper levels of the UN Secretariat, Assistant Secretary, Undersecretary, and SRSG, there are only 37 women compared to 129 men. So what kind of strategy would you do as Secretary General, because you do have authority on this aspect, to actually increase the number of women in these upper level positions in the Secretariat? Thank you.
Okay, those three.
Thank you very much. The protection of civilians and more specifically mobilizing civil society groups in the protection of civilians. There are a number, and this is something, for instance, you mentioned Myanmar. Croatia is a small country, but we actually finance two development cooperation projects in Myanmar. One was training for women community leaders, and the other was creating awareness of HIV/AIDS. And this was done with actually very little money because we didn't have much, but it worked. And this is something that is a very sort of heartfelt objective of mine, is to develop something or try to push for something that I would call the initiative in defense of small donors. In other words, to create as part of the international culture this notion that you don't have to be big and you don't have to be rich to provide development assistance. That you can even be a recipient of development assistance in some areas, whereas in other areas, you can provide development assistance to another country. For instance, Croatia was 4 years ago, 5 years ago, recipient of development assistance, and today is a provider. Although we could use some help also while providing help to the others. And developing this culture of actually going across borders and sharing what you know and what you're good at as part of your self-image, as part of creating the understanding of your own society, of who we are, but also of creating economic opportunities, of promoting communication, all kinds of other things. I think that would facilitate getting more people into projects like this, protecting civilians, teaching them how to protect themselves, sharing experience of how people did it in some other countries, and especially making people aware of the fact that it's not just them to whom these things are happening, that it's pretty universal. And I think it's important for the people on both sides of the divide, for the ones to whom these things are happening, to know that, you know, it's not something they've done, that these things simply are part of wars. For the ones that haven't had that experience, I think it's extremely important that it could happen to them. It really could. And believe me, until it happens to you, you deeply and strongly believe that it's impossible, absolutely impossible to happen to you. It could happen to some other savages, but not to you. And next day it happens to you. So this is also, I think, an important learning experience here. Reforming the Security Council would be my priority as Secretary General? A very strong no. I will not be reforming the Security Council as a Secretary General, fortunately. That is not because I don't think that there would be some advantages to that, but because this is very firmly placed in the hands of the member states. And this is something that the member states or negotiate and is part of this interstate procedure. And Secretary General can have an opinion, but probably nobody's too interested in her opinion on that. So the reform of the Security Council is certainly a very, very important issue, but I don't think that would be something that could be a priority of a Secretary General. However, opening these processes at the United Nations, including this one, I think is very useful, not only because it's fairer and this and so on, but because it raises the interest, it raises the public profile of the United Nations. It raises the interest of people around the world in what's happening to the United Nations. And this, to a large extent, is what the authority of the organization is based on. So, you know, if people care, then this is, and opening up the process, I think, increases interest, and through that also the fact that people care about the organization. And how would I change the 37 to 129 ratio? I would look for the best. I have done that in my ministry. And first of all, I would be very scared to be in a position like this and not have smarter people than me around me and people that know more about specific areas of their expertise than me. I think that's a prerequisite for having a chance of being successful. Also, when I came to and started leading the ministry, I didn't look specifically for gender balance. I was very nervous to produce success as soon as I could. By the way, 30 days in which we had Christmas and New Year's after we were sworn in as a government, we had the referendum on Croatia's accession to the European Union, and I was tasked with organizing that referendum. Having walked into the ministry at 6 o'clock in the evening on the 23rd of December, and having the referendum on the 23rd of January, and having to organize it and find out how to and with whom. And I simply walked through the corridors and pulled in people that were there and started working on that. We ended up we have something that's called collegium. That's sort of the minister, deputy minister, and assistant ministers, plus the secretary general of the ministry, etc. We ended up with a collegium in which we had 60-40 when we were lucky, 60% of women and 40% of men. But it was because I was looking for focus, performance, results, not too much fuss, and trying to show that we were moving forward as soon as I could. And the people who came in and were prepared to work long hours and were prepared to produce results were girls. What can I say? were the women who worked. I didn't bring them with me from, you know, party or anything else. They were there at the ministry. They were maybe encouraged by the fact that I was a woman, so they wanted to be part of that. Maybe that's part of the reason why they came forward. But they did. They came forward, they took a chance on me, and worked great. So I would certainly ask for high standards, but I would ask for also the common sense, the sort of politics of everyday life, which I really believe in. And that in itself very often brings out smart women.
Excellent. We'll take three more. I've already, way in the back, you'll be number one. Cora Weiss will be number two, and my colleague John Hirsch will be number three.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Pusić, thank you very much for coming here, and all the very best to you.
Could you identify yourself, please?
Sure. Matthias Campana from DPKO. And by the way, personally speaking, I fully support with what you have said here, and we wish also the best in implementing much-needed reforms in our organization. Dr. Pusić, you have mentioned on the HIV epidemic, reports have shown that it has been controlled, and there are studies that it will soon be eradicated. However, as a Secretary General, would you support further studies on the huge rates of autism cases that some scientists call an epidemic, and they have proved that there may be a link among vaccines and the mercury used in those preservatives in the shots that are given worldwide to most kids? Thank you.
Cora?
Thank you. Cora Weiss from the International Peace Bureau. By the way, there is an international law, it's called 1325, that requires women to be at all levels of decision-making, including in international institutions. So you've got the law with you if you want to use it. But my question is, there's a resurgence of talk about nuclear weapons and a resurgence of trade in weapons-grade materials. The Non-Proliferation Treaty was voted on by a huge majority of member states, and Article 6 says that member states agree to a good faith undertaking for the elimination of nuclear weapons. Would you be willing to make it a priority of your position to remind member states regularly about that good faith undertaking until we have a world without nuclear weapons? It's getting pretty dangerous.
Thank you. And John?
I'm John Hirsch with the International Peace Institute, along with Warren. And first of all, you are the first woman candidate to be the Secretary General who's ever been on this stage. So I really congratulate you. This is an important event for everybody in this room, and it's just great to have you here. I want to draw you out a little bit, particularly since you're from Croatia, on the role of the Secretary General in prevention of genocide. As you obviously know, this has just been last year, the 20th anniversary of the Srebrenica massacre. And a few months ago in the Trusteeship Council, there was a public meeting with the presence of the Secretary General, which commemorated the individuals who died in the Srebrenica massacre. And the Secretary General spoke. This is all on the public record. In the Security Council, a few days later, Russia vetoed a draft resolution to commemorate the genocide in support of Serbia. So and of course, going back 20 years ago, as you know, the Security Council was unable to prevent the genocide in Rwanda. And indeed, as you also know, the Secretary General at the time, Boutros Ghali, did not even warn the Security Council that a genocide was imminent, notwithstanding the report from General Dallaire to him that this was all kind of kept down. So given that history, in other words, the UN has tried to act afterward, including the conviction now of Radovich Karadzic by the ICC. But I'd like you to say something about how you would see the role of the Secretary General in trying to mobilize the Security Council in particular with regard to the prevention of genocide. Thank you very much.
Good question.
Would I declare the autism or make this a priority? To be honest, I think this is an extremely important thing. It wouldn't be a priority. Outside of big epidemics, that would be a priority, but as such, dealing with them, because I don't think it has been very dealt with very effectively, regardless of what kind of epidemic we are talking about. But we need to, as the international community, I think, develop a more effective and more flexible and faster way of reacting to epidemics in general. That I do think, and I've seen this very clearly, and we have all seen this very clearly in the case of Ebola, for instance, where probably a lot more could have been done if there was a faster reaction. And I think this is something that the UN needs to work on. 1325, also one of my favorite resolutions, and we worked on that in both Croatia and the countries were in our neighborhood and the countries that we worked with on development cooperation. And I would definitely continue working on and expanding on that. But non-proliferation treaty and reminding all the countries, but especially all the nuclear powers of the good faith and undertaking, you can believe me, I really would. I would remind them regularly, but not only remind them, try to introduce countries that approached it in a different way in order to deal with this problem and with this issue, where the facts on the ground were very often going one step forward, two steps back. So I think it would be very important. The role of the Secretary General in basically encouraging the Security Council to abstain from the veto in cases of genocide. I think that would be important, but there are so many other things that are part of that issue and I think that need addressing. For instance, one thing that Srebrenica is an excellent, I mean, horrible, but excellent case in point, where you have to be aware of what you are doing and what is the mandate of the UN peacekeepers in any given situation. If you send a relatively small contingent of UN peacekeepers into the heart of a horrible war, where there are hundreds of thousands of people being killed, where there are warring armies and certainly no peace to be kept, and they have the mandate to keep peace, and the wars have changed from the classical wars into wars where the civilians are the primary target, you're almost destined to tragedy and not succeeding. So I think it's very important to match the mandate of the peacekeepers to the proportions of the task, to the size of the task and type of the task that you're giving them. Otherwise, it demoralizes everybody. Ends up in tragedy like Srebrenica, and in a way, it becomes, you know, such a huge problem, such a huge obstacle to normalization for decades to come. You said that the Russian Federation vetoed the commemoration of Srebrenica in order to sort of in support of Serbia. I think this is not support of Serbia. I think that Serbia actually, because Serbia today isn't and shouldn't be Slobodan Milosevic and shouldn't be obliged to defend Slobodan Milosevic. There's no country on the planet that hasn't in its history had maniacs running it. This is, you know, this is a fact. And why should you, who have put so much effort into actually fighting those guys and winning and creating a better government, maybe it's not fantastic, but certainly better than what you had during these horrible atrocities, why should you be tasked with defending the guys that you were against to begin with and that you also suffered from their policies and their actions? So, you know, I can be critical of the Serbian government. I can be critical of my own government and have been many times in the past. But I definitely don't think they should be compared to Slobodan Milosevic. That they're not.
Thank you. Thank you. We'll take three more. One of my favorite questioners is way back in the room, but I see his hand. Jeff, you'll be number one. Number two here in the second row. And number three, this gentleman, right. So first, Jeff Laurenti, but please identify yourself.
Jeff Laurenti. Thank you, Beatrice. Jeff Laurenti. Minister Pusić, to what extent are you reconciled to the quantity and quality of troops that are made available for UN peacekeeping by a fairly short list of member states? To what extent do countries in your immediate region participate by sending troops in UN peacekeeping? And how important do you think it is to bring in units from militarily capable states, leading states, that have till now, over the past couple decades, shunned participation in UN peacekeeping? Is that an important priority going forward over the next 10 years that presumably the next Secretary General will have responsibility for administering these?
We need the microphone up here.
Lucy Webster from Economists for Peace and Security. I have long thought that there's an enormous role for people in all countries throughout the world, and particularly all the young men and women who are lacking a sense of purpose in life and are going for ridiculous objectives in order to give themselves a sense of purpose, which has become a real problem now. But there are lots of UN proposals, the programs of action of a whole lot of conferences over the years are, to a large extent, just hortatory documents without very much energy putting into the implementation. So I would like a new Secretary General to be an activist in engaging civil society in implementing the various programs for local action, for monitoring problems, and for keeping track of encouraging their local governments, their national governments, et cetera, to take action. I would like this to be done in a way that would give lots and lots of young men and women and people in general a sense of purpose, which they seem to lack now.
Thank you. And then the gentleman here.
Hello, Maximilian Hoppe from Friedrich Ebert Foundation here in New York. My first question concerns you in a way that you're also a known figure in Brussels in a way, and I would like to know what went actually wrong that the European Union wasn't able to come up with a single candidate? That was the first question. Secondly, you wrote in your letter of intent that you would like to consider yourself more as a CEO running the United Nations. Would that potentially also include privatization or outsourcing of certain UN roles? That would be all.
Okay. Lucy didn't really ask a question, but you should feel free to know whether you agree with her.
No, but she reminded me of something that I actually think is very important.
But the first question, remind me again.
Troops.
Back in Jeffrey Hill.
Peacekeepers.
Quantity of troops.
Peacekeepers, quantity and quality, actually. So how many? Certainly too few at the moment. And where from? And this is this obvious north-south divide where the richer countries and institutionally, I would say, more completed or more stable countries with older institutions tend to give money but not provide troops. And countries with younger institutions, in other words, also the military with less of a tradition of following certain rules and procedures, being more likely to provide troops. I actually think that is a problem. I also think that there are some things that we might be able to do even without changing the world. In other words, persuading the rich and sophisticated to send the troops, because that would be very difficult and is difficult. And part of the reason we have this situation is precisely because they don't want to. One thing that could be done, first of all, a number of UN peacekeeping missions don't have a defined exit date and exit strategy. And they keep sitting in different places for years, sometimes decades, nobody quite knowing what to do and what they're doing there, and sometimes doing what they shouldn't be doing there. And to shorten the mandate and define clearly what are they doing, and after they have finished doing it, to get out and use negotiators to perform the tasks of building institutions, bringing formerly warring parties together, encouraging indigenous civil society, meaning the civil society from these countries, to take over some of the tasks of reconciliation, rebuilding of societies, rebuilding of institutions. It's doable. It's possible. This is something that I can really tell you firsthand. I mean, we tried it and it works. It's hard at the beginning, but you can do it, and it's important to do that. Sometimes it's really key to do it yourself. And for that, you maybe need a few smart, well-organized, and supportive and well-meaning people who will help you with these things, more than you need troops. Troops you need when you're in the, you need to keep the two armies apart or the two warring parties apart. For everything else, you need to, A, mobilize people from these societies, and you need, I think, good mediators. So those are the things you can do without changing the world, so to speak, without persuading the rich to do what they don't want to do. But also, I think it really is important, even before you can persuade people to do what they don't want to do, it's important to have some kind of screening of the troops that you are sending to as peacekeepers, regardless of which country they're coming from. And I think there is no point in sending them if the task is way above and beyond what they can do in terms of numbers and mandate. You mentioned the civil society initiatives as something that A, would be important in general, but B, would also give young people who are sort of a little disoriented something to do and focus on. That reminded me of something that I've been thinking about for a long time in looking into national politics, international politics, media in general, maybe you know, also the I don't know, arts, movies, whatever you want to look at, that on the social media, you have almost as a rule, if you look at the national media or internationally or any which way, as a rule, you almost always have the narrow-minded, bigoted, angry people control or being the majority, controlling the discourse, so to speak. There's always more of them than people who somehow want something good or positive. And if you do, you have to justify yourself. If you want to bite somebody's head off, you don't have to justify it at all. But if you want something that's positive, you have to justify why this is not, you know, sort of too either cynical or somehow mushy. And we, I think, and kids are, young people are on the social media all the time. And if we could somehow, I was thinking in terms of the revolution of the philosophers, you know, if we could somehow bring into this discourse in the social media some of the values that you know, now people are almost embarrassed to defend or to promote, you know, such as freedom, compassion, some of the old-fashioned enlightenment goals, and some of the not-so-old-fashioned progress goals, simply development goals, simply having a future goals, you know, being optimistic, which sort of gives you the energy to be creative in whichever way. Whether we can find ways to actually move this into the social media and somehow focus on these topics and have more discussion on these topics, I think would influence a number of things, including bringing more purpose to the young people, but also including getting more creative ideas for dealing with some of the issues that the UN deals with and wants to deal with and is somehow stuck into this vicious circle of too much organization and too little, whatever, heart and brains, sort of. I certainly never said I was going to be a CEO of the United Nations. It wasn't me. That's not my style. But to some extent, I will have to be, or whoever is elected will have to be that. And I would definitely be more in the category of people who would like to address more the objectives of the United Nations and the goals that the United Nations has had over time and needs to maybe reposition, rethink, but still needs to engage with. But regardless of that fact, whoever is elected Secretary General would also need to think of the costs, of the fact that you cannot hire anybody, and if you manage to hire somebody, you cannot fire that person. That there is no performance-based evaluation and selection, or very little. That there are different agencies and organizations that are doing the same thing, and you can't do much about it. That there are different organizations and segments of the organization that are doing compatible things and things that should be compatible, that are not talking to each other and not working with each other. That there is the issue of money. That there is an issue of being blocked, and a lot of that being a question of interstate negotiations rather than a decision of a person or somebody who is Secretary General. There is a lot of that, and the Secretary General obviously will have to get involved, and whoever she is, she will have to get involved with this, with these problems, because those are the issues that affect the performance and the outcome. But if by any strange combination of circumstances I am elected, I will definitely be aware of that, and I will definitely know that this is something that I need to deal with. But to be honest, I will enjoy other things more.
We're almost out of time. Dr. Pusić began with an observation I just wanted to cite in closing, which was that this open process that we all welcome this time, as opposed to what's gone before, means that being a candidate itself is important. And I think you proved that by the forthright way which you've answered questions in your statement. So thank you so much for participating in this and making this experiment already successful.
Thank you so much. Thank you.